Sanjit, good afternoon to all. And first of all, my apologies because I got stuck in the another event, which lasted a little longer. And I could hear that there was introduction, but I couldn't really join it. Did not could attend whatever has been deliberated till now. And I'm told that Honorable Sri Prabhuji has already spoken, and I'm sure that after his speech, I think then saying anything will be a kind of the subset of whatever he would have explained. We all know Sri Prabhuji, who has immense contribution, and he is the, we can call him the father of Electricity Act 2003, which has really transformed the sector, and he has been involved in the other infrastructure projects. So I'm sure that whatever I will be saying, probably it may be some kind of very, very small thing what he would have already mentioned. But first of all, I think thanks for inviting me, Jashu Bhai, and Mr. Jha. I think those the two persons who had been constantly doing this conference every year, which is a very laudable. And I think our director of project, Mr. Ujjwal Bhattacharya, despite of his not keeping well, he is making his presence here. And so that is also, I think, then a laudable. Mr. Derek Shah, I can see him. I think that is also his contribution, and all others who are present. First of all, let me, I think, just mention that the topic what has been selected is the energy transition with progressive decarbonization of the energy. I think this is a factual statement. It cannot be just like a switch on and switch off, and we may be saying that after 1 year or after 2 years, we are not going to have any carbon-related energy sources. And carbon is an integral part of the universe, integral part of the human society, and for all of us. So we will not be able to take out the carbon, because without carbon, the life at this earth is impossible. So what we have to do is that how we can really reduce the carbon and decarbonizing as much as possible. And we as NTPC are trying to play our role in the country's quest in moving towards low carbon, less carbon, and ultimately, maybe some people who have coined this terminology called net zero. But when it will be achieved, I think that will be still a debate. And I don't think then anybody will be able to estimate that when we will be able to really reach, because carbon dioxide is such a thing that unless the whole globe is going to become the net zero, or this really have worked together in synchronism, it's not possible for one country or the two countries, because it's a common phenomena as far as the carbon is concerned, whether it is emitted here or whether it is emitted in US or whether it is emitted in any other part of the globe. So what I think today's conference and today's topic, and I'm sure that in the next 3 days there will be many topics which are being deliberated, that will go in a long way for just going in the transition. And what we normally just observe, that some of the time we are moving very fast, but we feel that we are not doing enough. I think in the last 4 or 5 years, or rather than 7 or 8 years, we have what has been done by India is very commendable, and it has been lauded across the globe. When we become the part of any system, we may be thinking that it is the speed is slow. But if you just look back and try to see that what has been done, I think it is quite laudable. And going forward, it's not only that we have to maintain the same speed, but we may have to accelerate that changes and the transition. We all have to be very careful that the transition should be as painless as possible. And that is where the just transition comes into. The just transition means that the idea of the fair and inclusive energy transition that leaves no one behind and considers the communities that will bear the worst impact of the decarbonization. I think we have to keep this in mind. So it is very easy to say that we should not be just going for the hydrocarbons, but it is going to be a very slow exercise. Our challenge is then how we can really accelerate. I think that is the only question which we should be really. And I think our dependence on the coal sources is going to be at least for 2 to 3 decades, if not more. I'm sure that it may be even more than that. So what we have to start finding out, I think it's a multi-pronged kind of strategy. The one is that go aggressive on the renewables, whether it is solar or wind. And further, try to see that whatever generation we are doing on the hydrocarbons or the carbon related, it is more and more efficient. I think moving towards the supercritical genesis units was one of the objective of those kind of things. Unfortunately, we don't have this enough domestic gas, and the international gas price is always fluctuating. Today, we all know that international gas prices are almost trading in the range of anywhere, because it's not even a fixed price, anywhere between $30 to $40 per MMBTU, which is almost unaffordable for any China kind of society. No, forget about the emerging or the underdeveloped China, the nations across the globe. So what we have to do is that we have to see that we are looking at the energy sources which are where we have the control, and we try to reduce the carbon footprint in that. Before that, I just come to some of the things what we at NTPC are doing. I think as a country, we have done a great job of connecting each and every house with electricity grid. We all know that in 18 months of time, 2.6 crores this households were connected. And that will lead a kind of then that will be a foundation for going towards more and more cleaner sources of the energy. And in my opinion, I think that will go in a long way to see that each and every citizens of the country uses the clean source of energy, which is the cleanest source of energy is electricity. So as a consumer, if you are consuming the electricity, I think that is the cleanest form of energy. And then what we have to see that it is available 24/7, it is affordable, it is reliable. And furthermore, I think the onus should be that how we can go on greening the grid and making sure that it is reliable and affordable always. So that is the kind of the transition in the decarbonizing the energy, which in my opinion is going to play a very vital role. We all know that today, I think we are only an electricity usage in the country is around 18%. How we can go more and more, at least reach to the direct energy consumption side. If you can go towards, let us say, 40 to 50%, that will be a very, very big achievement. We at NTPC, I was just trying to mention on that part, we have taken up something, another important step in our endeavor to have the Blue Sky Initiative, wherein we have started and we have enabled each and every farmer, each and every entrepreneur who can aggregate the biomass, and we are providing the market for that biomass. Biomass, we all know that it is a part of the renewable energy because it has whatever the carbon dioxide is going to come, it has already captured on that. So it's a kind of the best of the recycling kind of technology. So we believe that even if 10% of the total biomass we will be able to bring to the electricity energy generating power stations, primarily the coal-based power stations, it will be adding quite a substantial amount of that. We all know that the country's targets, what Honorable Prime Minister has really set, the 450 gigawatt by 2030. And many of the experts had some kind of apprehension when this 175 gigawatt was declared. But I think today nobody is having that any kind of doubt in that. And I'm sure that by 2030, we as a country will be able to achieve more than 450 gigawatt in every case. We as NTPC, we have already stated, and we are working continuously on that, that we will be achieving almost 60 gigawatt by 2032. And we endeavor to become almost 50% renewable along with the 50% of the coal-based generation. So those kind of steps, what the company like ours, which we are taking, I hope and I would request each and every company, whether it is a consumer or whether it is an electricity generator, they should be also focusing on this thing and they should invest on these kind of steps, whether it is going to be renewable energy or whether it's going to be energy efficiency. I think that is very, very important part. We know that some of the our old plants are very inefficient. And we must try to see that how if we can really replace or we can carry out the R&M of those plants in a shortest possible time and we can recover their efficiency or further improve their efficiency, that will go in a long way. The another aspect which I would like to share here is that NTPC as a proactive and as a responsible company, we have signed the Energy Compact with UN. And we were the first energy company to sign this. And that one is that by 2032, we will be 60 gigawatt on RE, renewable energy. We will reduce the energy intensity by 10% compared to 2012. I think earlier the baseline would have been much kind of before. And we will work with the international alliances. We have already started taking steps for the using this FGDs and the DNOx equipments to bring down the emission levels. The main pillar of the transition today are renewables, electrification and efficiency. The important synergy in the energy transition shall be combination of the increased use of renewable energy and wider use of electricity to power and use application in the transport and power process industry. I think when we are coming towards the transport and the process industry, it is quite a kind of potential to go towards decarbonization. The transport sector, which is consuming a lot of imported fuel, not only the carbon emitting, but the imported fuel, I think we all know that how fast the EV segment is really progressing. The growth has been tremendous, and I think it is going to be much more. And once we are going towards the electric vehicles, that will be really reducing the carbon dioxide emissions. And more than that, what I would like to share here that we as NTPC are trying to play our role. We have already put more than 100 kind of this electric chargers. Our team is working on the electric vehicles. And in addition to that, even we are working on the hydrogen buses so that in our project in Leh, we are working on the hydrogen buses. Unfortunately, we are not able to get the bus. That's where this is coming kind of on the way at present, but we are working and how we will be able to really take care of that. Another step what as NTPC we are trying to take is that we are working on this something like MSW if we can convert into the fuel. Our project in Banaras will be able to demonstrate that we can convert the MSW rather than the only energy at the small units which are inefficient. If we can convert that into fuel, which can be fired along with the coal in the coal-based plants, that will also go in a long way. Other things what is very, very promising is the energy storage or the energy-related solutions. We all know about the batteries, what kind of steps are being taken, the battery, even there are PLIs and this production linked incentives, or this is already enacted by the government. What I would like to emphasize here is there is a great scope for hydrogen, green hydrogen. And I think about the 10 years back where the solar or the solar PV was there, probably today it is on the electrolyzers. And as the more and more investment will go into electrolyzers, the efficiency of the electrolyzers will improve. I'm told that earlier it used to be almost around 55 to 60 units per kg of hydrogen. Today, people are claiming that it can come below 50. I think yesterday I was hearing Janet from Mai Jananetra in charge that it can come down to almost 46, 47 units. That means the efficiency can go as high as 80% kind of thing. And then we will have to work towards something called circular economy. If we can, and for that, the green hydrogen and the carbon capture, these are the two main ingredients. Our Netra team is also working on the carbon capture solutions. And I'm sure that Mr. Bhattacharya, director of project, would have also already mentioned that we are working on the demonstration project for 20 TPD, wherein we will be capturing carbon dioxide and using the green green energy and produce green hydrogen and in turn produce methanol. So those kind of projects, today it may be looking like a lab size, but in the coming decade or so, it will start then picking up the pace, and maybe after about two decades, it will become a norm. So what we believe is that the future, the coal-based plants will become a kind of center for the process industries, where we will have not only the power, but we will have the carbon dioxide or this and kind of the other methanol kind of things where we can be even producing and then supplying the feedstock. So there is a lot many activities and the exciting future. So as we are working towards a decarbonization, we will have to see that how we can really train our people, we can retraining so that the people who will be losing the job in the carbon intensive industries, they will be able to go towards the renewable sectors or related sectors. So the education and the skill development and going towards the training towards the new technologies will play an important role. And knowledge sharing and the technology transfer from the countries, organizations, wherever these are. And we should also, as a country, we should focus on that, what we can develop rather than be dependent on the kind of high cost imports, even in the kind of the equipments. I think that will be also quite important. On the hydrogen side, I just missed one point which I must add here, that at present, most of the hydrogen is coming from the demineralized water. Our Netra is working on how to have the hydrogen from the seawater also. I think that will be easing out the pressure on the water resources. That will go in a long way. And the another one is the high temperature electrolysis, which will be requiring far less energy than the what is the normal than electrolysis required. I'm sure that these things will be discussed during next two to three days, and there will be many more inputs will be coming from the both academia as well as the industry. And I'm sure that at the end of the 3 days, you will be coming out with some kind of recommendations, which if implemented will be paving the way for the transition and decarbonization that. So let me at the end, thank the organizers for inviting me. I'm sure that the deliberations will be very rich and will be very practical, and it will be really helping the country going for the decarbonization. Thank you. Thank you very much.